Okay, so it looks like it's starting to be recording. Okay, so today I want to talk about coordinate systems. Sadly, I am just back from attending a funeral for one of my cousins who is a big Star Trek fan. So in her honor, I wanted to use two Star Trek references. Anybody original Star Trek series fans? Do you know this is the extra credit for today? What episode is this? It's the same as the one in front of you. So there's this one, and then the other one. And yes, at the time, this was considered good special effects. Right. First one is from Balance of Terror. Second is from the Corbinite Maneuver. Any James Bond fans? Do you know the Goldfinger scene? Okay, very similar. The Corbinite Maneuver is one of the best bluffs in TV history. All right. So I want to start off with equations of planes. Equation of planes. And so the example was the Federation has a couple of bases, and the Romulans, we believe it's the Romulans, have been destroying them. And so the question is, did the Federation put all of its bases in a plane? Now, if so, is this a really bad idea in three-dimensional space in the Milky Way galaxy? Well, if you think about how big the galaxy is much, much longer than it is right. Is that a phone? It's a watch. Oh, I will have to update the cell phone watch policy. Okay, so it does not count because it was only phones. So the galaxy is much wider, longer than it is thick. So it might not necessarily be that bad to put all the bases in a plane. You might not be missing too much. Anybody ever see the movie Laser Team? They actually continued with some episodes, I don't know if this was online or just on YouTube, where the incompetent people decide to build a small wall around the Earth's equator to stop the aliens from attacking. And you know, there's this great briefing where they go, can't they just go? So my question here is, how would you tell if all the bases from the Federation are in a plane? Well, we need to figure out what the equation of a plane is. So let's try to generalize what we did from a line. So what inputs do you think you need for the equation of a plane? So what did we have for a line? We had a base point, and we had a direction. So here, we'll have a base point, and now what do you think we need in addition to the base point? So one possibility is two directions. So we will actually get back to that later. That is a great way to do the plane. It's not really in the book right now, but it's something I want to do today. So it's a great thing, but we're going to put that on pause for now. Yes? A normal direction. So, normal direction time. So in three-dimensional space, if I give you a direction and say I want everything perpendicular to that, that's going to span a plane. And so if I want to draw things, here's my point, here's the origin. Here's some point P0. Here's the normal direction. And then I'll want a plane of all vectors perpendicular to that. So one way is I could talk about moving from P0 to another point in here. But really, if I had this point here, it's really coming from the origin. So if this is my vector V, which is a generic point in the plane, I'll write V as x, y, z. I'll write P0 as px, py, pz, and I'll write the normal vector as nx, ny, nz. There are a lot of different letters you could choose to write this. I could write the normal as abc. I'm just trying to write it like this to really emphasize what's going on and where the points are coming from. So here's my point v. Maybe I'll make it a little closer. What would be this vector from here to here? How would I write that vector? What would that vector be? So I start here, I go to P0, and then I add this vector and I get to V. Not P naught plus V, because then that would take me to 2 P naught plus V. P naught minus V would get me to 2 P naught minus V. So you're close. I've got to get, it's P naught to here. What do I have to add to P naught to end up at V?
V minus
P naught. So this would be V minus P naught. If you look at it, I'm taking this and I'm subtracting that. This is what's left over. P naught plus V minus P naught will just be V. So what's the relationship between V minus P naught and the normal vector? What should their relationship be? Yes. The dot product should be zero. They should be perpendicular. So if I take this dot product, I should get zero. So am I getting zero the number or zero the vector?
Number.
This is a number. You always want to ask, you, am I expecting a vector to come out, a matrix, a number? This should be a number. This will give me the equation of a plane. It will be all points V such that V minus P naught dotted with N equals zero. Now let's try to rewrite this in a way that's a little bit more illuminating. So this is the, so we would get, an x, and y, and z dotted with x minus px, y minus py, z minus pz equals zero. So then I get nx times x plus ny times y plus nz times z equals d, say, where d is nx px plus ny py plus nz pz, or just n dotted with p naught. So let's stop and look at the formula. You know, when I take the dot product, I get nx times x minus nx times px. So I've just put all the minuses on the other side. And I'm just calling that D. This is the equation of a plane. Okay? And the way you calculate D, it's just your normal vector dotted with your base point. Can there be more than one base point for a plane? Yeah. How many base points do you think you could have for a plane? Infinitely many. If you could, what point would you love to have as your base point? 0, 0, 0. You'd love to have the origin. So if the plane goes to the origin, it's often nice to use that as your base point. Okay? But you may not be so fortunate. All right, well, if you don't, you just have some other point P naught. And now you're basically saying N dotted with your vector is equal to some fixed constant. This is the generalization of a line. Okay. And if I just give you a different base point, it will just change some of these numbers, but it's not going to fundamentally change what things look like. Okay? All right. So this is one way to do the equation of a plane. There's another way to do the equation of a plane, which was, you know, suggested a moment ago, is to look at two directions. And what I like about that approach is it gives you a sense geometrically what's going on. So we'll have a base point P naught, and we'll have directions V and W. So we look at what's going on now. Here's zero again. Here's P naught. And let's say here's V, here's W, and you'll get a plane like this. And so I'll write the equation of a plane will be a function of two variables, S and T. And it will be P naught plus S times the vector V plus T times the vector W. So what I like about this approach is you can see really the two-dimensional aspect of it. How many dimensions does a line have? Line? One. Line has one dimension. So once you know the x-coordinate, you know the y-coordinate. How many dimensions does the plane have? Two. Once you know the x and the y-component, you know the z-component. Well, if we look at our formula for the d over here, we see once we know x and y, since we know what z is, since we know what d is, we would then figure out what d is, what z is. So once we know two, the third is determined. This is just another way of saying we have just two free variables. And if you know the two directions, this is a great way to go. What do you think must be true about V and W for this to be a plane? So if they were either equal or if one was in the same direction as the other, then this will not give you a plane. What would this give you if they're in the same direction? It will give you a line. And you can have the discussion, is a line a degenerate plane? I really don't want to have that discussion. So we'll just say V and W should not be allowed to be in the same direction. Okay, what if they're in different directions, but they're not perpendicular? Is that okay? So if they weren't perpendicular, so maybe this is V, this is W. So we would get almost this kind of like slanted coordinate system. Is that okay? Yeah. Is it fundamentally different than the regular Cartesian coordinate system? No. You're just really angling one direction a little bit over the other. It's not that big of a difference. Later today, we'll see big differences when we get to the big three coordinate systems. But this is not that big of a deal. Right? And there may be times when it's convenient to look at something that's slightly shifted like this. If you look at the printout of the border area between the United Federation, this was before the Federation. This is so early in season one, I don't think they say Federation yet. This will talk about the Earth outposts. If you look at the map there, you will see that the two different directions are not the same amount. Going up, down is different than going left, right, in terms of how they're doing the grid. But it's still at least a perpendicular coordinate system. Perpendicular coordinate systems are really nice. They allow you to very quickly figure out what the coordinates are, but we can still work with something like this. Alright, so there's a lot of different ways now you can do problems on planes. You know, the biggest thing is, can you write down the equation of a plane? Well, we need some inputs. One is to give me two directions and a base point. Another is to give me a base point and a normal direction. What if I give you three points? Should three points determine a plane? So how would we figure out if we give you three points? So say, example, so we have P, Q, and R. So we have three points here, 0, I want to find the equation of the plane containing the points P, Q, and R. Three points will always determine a plane. It could be a degenerate plane if they fall along a line, but in general, it will be a plane. So I want to somehow convert this to what I know. So I've got to either figure out a base point and a normal direction, or I've got to figure out two directions and a base point. Are there any candidates for the base point?
You can just use any of the points as the base point.
Good. So for a second. Okay. So any of the three points could be the base point. Right? Which should we use as the base point? P, Q, or R?
P.
P. Right? Why P? Alphabetically first. Okay. So we'll use P as the base point. Okay. Now what should we do?
And then you can draw lines to the other two points for directions.
So these could be my directions. So this could be my direction V. This could be my direction W. So V could be Q minus P. W could be R minus P. So I could use now the two directions version. Or if I wanted to use the point and normal, how could I get the normal direction? What could I do? Yes? Yeah, take the cross product. what if I get V and W in the wrong order? You know, I didn't get home until after midnight. I'm really tired. Rolled them down the wrong way. Is that bad? What would happen if I got V and W in the opposite order? Yes? It would just point in the opposite direction. So if I want to find all the things perpendicular to this, is that really the same as finding all the things perpendicular to its negative? Yeah, there's no difference. You'll be multiplying everything through by negative one. Not going to change anything. There's a great joke of a classical scholar who spent their entire life trying to prove the Iliad and the Odyssey were not written by Homer, but by another blind Greek of the same name. It doesn't matter which order I do V cross W. Does it matter if N is unit length or not? Should N be unit length? No. If I multiply N by a factor of 5, I'm going to just change D by a factor of 5. I'll change the dot product by a factor of 5. Perfectly fine. I don't have to worry about making this a unit vector. I can just calculate V cross W. And as long as V and W are not in the same direction, this will work perfectly. Right? So this is how you would calculate equations of planes. This is geometrically what's going on, very similar to what we were doing with lines. And we're going to use this in calculus when we want to try to expand. Okay. Any other questions right now on equations of planes? So you can teach Calc 150 many different ways. You can do a very geometric approach with lots of plots and pictures. I really do not want to do that. I want to do more on the application side. How will we use this? So, you know, one of my favorite lectures is when we use this to figure out some stuff in Major League Baseball. You know, another is when we use this to figure out linear regression. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do the big three coordinate systems. Every now and then in mathematics, we get names right. Who can tell me what secant is in mathematics? What is secant of theta? Who remembers their trig?
One over sine.
No.
One over cosine.
One over cosine. Why would you say one over sine? Because if mathematicians were kind, they would associate secant with sine and cosecant with cosine. We at least got cotangent and tangent right, okay? You know, one out of three. Although, who sings that you need to have two out of three to be not bad? I think this is more 70s than 80s. Meatloaf, two out of three ain't bad. So, one out of three, that's bad, okay? Why would you want sine and secant to be together? Well, then cosine and cosecant would be together. It would be very easy to remember. Sadly, we don't have that. The way I remember it is I remember it by mathematicians being cruel to us and forcing us to spend all of our time memorizing things we shouldn't have to. But every now and then we actually have good notation. What do you think cylindrical coordinates are good to study? Cylinders! What do you think spherical coordinates are good to study? Spheres. If you see anything that's cylindrical, think cylindrical. Anything that's spherical, think spherical coordinates. And what do you think polar coordinates are good to study? Circles. All right, so here two out of three ain't bad. All right, they're not called circular coordinates, they're called polar coordinates. All right, so x is our cosine theta, y is our sine theta, r is the square root of x squared plus y squared, theta is arctangent of y over x, sometimes written as tangent to the negative 1 of y over x. We assume r is greater than or equal to 0, 0 less than or equal to theta, less than 2 pi, and here is the picture. Here's theta, here's r, here's x, here's y. This is just r cosine theta, this is r sine theta. So I can give you something in x, y coordinates, and this tells you what things would be in r theta coordinates. Over here. So if I give you x, y, this is what r theta would be. If I give you r and theta, this is what x and y would be. There is one point where we have some issues. How many of you have ever been to a foreign country and had to exchange money? Okay. Normally the way it works is you give money to somebody in your currency, and then they give you money back in the foreign country's currency, modulo a small transaction fee. We will assume now that there's no transaction fee. Right? So if I change how much money I give, I know exactly how much money I'll get back. There's a nice one-to-one correspondence. I give you $100, I know how many lira I get. I give you $1,000, I know how many lira I get. Most of the time, if I give you an X and a Y, there's a unique R and theta. Or if I give you an R and a theta, there's a unique X and Y. This is one of the reasons why we assume R is greater than or equal to zero. If R was allowed to be negative, well, if I'm going out, and I can go out R here, and then all the way around like this, a huge amount theta, or I could have R just go out negative like this, and just have a different angle. So by having the angle go all the way from 0 to pi, I don't need to have any negative angles. What's the one point where things break down? Where if I give you an x and a y, there's multiple r thetas that work. So there's one place that's an issue. What's the one place where things break down? Where it's not clear what at least one of the R theta would be. We could have multiple working.
Zero, zero.
Yes, 0, 0. Excellent. This corresponds to I equals 0, and theta is free. Because once I equals 0, does theta matter? No. So unfortunately, the coordinate system, the transformation breaks down at the point 0, 0. Sadly, this is bad in general, but fortunately for us, it breaks down in a very nice way at just one point. We're going to be able to get around it. So it's not going to be too bad for us. Okay? So how many of you have never seen polar coordinates before? Okay. Sometimes they've shown them in like an algebra class, and they allow you to rewrite figures instead of writing things in Cartesian coordinates, writing things in polar coordinates. What I want to do is I want to look at some shapes in polar coordinates and some shapes in Cartesian coordinates. So in Cartesian, let's consider x squared plus y squared equals 1. So what kind of shape would x squared plus y squared equals 1 be? It's a circle. So here's my x-axis. Here's my y-axis. It's just a circle of radius 1. Okay, we've all seen circles before. Let's look at it in polar coordinates. How would you write x squared plus y squared equals 1 in polar coordinates? So you could substitute in for r cosine theta for x and r sine theta for y, and you would get r cosine theta squared plus r sine theta squared equals 1. But what's this going to simplify to?
R equals 1.
So we first get r squared equals 1, but then since r has to be non-negative, we just get r equals 1. So let's plot this in polar coordinates. Here's r, here's theta. So what is r equal 1 going to look like in polar coordinates? It's a line. It starts at, it's r equals 1, and it goes all the way up to height 2 pi. This is what a circle looks like in polar coordinates. Okay, this is maybe beginning to see why we like polar coordinates. You know, a very difficult geometric object like a circle is now converted to a straight line. A straight line is much easier to look at. Instead of looking at x squared plus y squared equals 1, we could look instead not at a circle, but at a disk. And so if we looked at a disk, so in Cartesian, let's look at x squared plus y squared is less than equal to 1. here's X, here's Y. It's now just a filled in disk. What would this equation be in polar coordinates? So what would X squared plus Y squared less than or equal to 1 become in polar coordinates?
R is less than or equal to
1. R is less than or equal to 1. And now if I were to plot this in polar coordinates, here's R, here's theta, here's 2 pi, here's 1. So a circle in polar coordinates is just a rectangle. The whole idea in integration in several variables is, as a rule of thumb, if you had your choice, you would much rather have a nice region of integration and a bad integrand than a nice integrand and a bad region of integration. So this allows us to pass from integrating over circles to integrating over boxes. So let me just show you how you would set up an integration over a circle in Cartesian coordinates. So for the unit circle, what's the smallest x can be?
Zero.
Nope. What's the smallest x can be on the unit circle?
Negative.
Negative 1. So you would have x goes from negative 1 to 1. And then y would go from negative the square root of 1 minus x squared to positive the square root of 1 minus x squared. So once you know what x is, since x squared plus y squared is 1, y squared is 1 minus x squared, so y is plus or minus the square root of 1 minus. So you can see for your region of integration, if I want to do this in Cartesian coordinates, I've now got square roots coming into play. If I do this in polar coordinates, r goes from 0 to 1, theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. The integration looks like it's going to be much nicer. Whether or not we can do the integration is another question. You know, we'll discuss and develop techniques, but I want to try to show you why we're spending all of our time on this. Now we have two essentially, hopefully, independent, nice calc 1 integrals. The bounds of one are independent of the bounds of the other. Whereas in the first one, oh Lord, you know, as I change x, my bounds of integration change involving a square root sign. So this is the quick motivation for why we like things like polar coordinates. Building on a successful polar coordinates, it's time to go up to cylindrical coordinates. Cylindrical coordinates are extremely easy if you know polar coordinates. Essentially, all that happens is you just have z is along for the y. So to go from polar to cylindrical, you just add z equals z. That's it. Okay. Really not much of a change. Okay, the last one is the more involved one. This is the spherical coordinates. How many of you are physics students? Okay. So I was a double geek as a student. I was both physics and math. And the two different departments had two different notations for spherical coordinates. And they were not the same. So I see at least one person shaking their head. So have you had this problem?
No, but I can see why.
So in physics, we often used theta was the angle coming down from the z-axis. And in math, we would use phi as the angle coming down from the z-axis. The book uses phi as the angle coming down from the z-axis. It is the better choice. You always want to reduce things to a previously solved problem. And by using phi, we are going to try to reduce this to an earlier coordinate system. What do you think is the earlier coordinate system that's lurking in spherical?
Polar.
And so we want to reserve theta to be in the xy plane because that's what we used in polar. Right? Before I delve into spherical, I want you to make one last remark over here. I wrote arctan and I wrote tangent inverse. Which is the better notation, arctan or tangent inverse? Arctan. Why is arctan the better notation?
People might think it's the tangent of x over y.
They might think it's what?
They
might think it's 1 over the tangent of y over x. And so because it's not clear, is this the inverse function or is this the reciprocal? They're not necessarily the same, unfortunately. That's why it's better to use arctan. It's just clear this is the inverse of the function. This is one of the places where the notation is a little bit confusing. Okay, so let's do spherical coordinates. And so our goal is to come up with a good way to describe points on a sphere. And this is why I chose the Cobomite maneuver episode, because the Enterprise encounters an extremely large alien spaceship, which is a giant sphere. And you know, again, when you think about these special effects at the time, what can we do very easily? We can make a big ball and have lots of smaller balls on it. You know, budgets were tight back in the 60s. Spherical coordinates. That's the sphere. Right. Let's think about what's going on. Here's my x-axis, here's my y-axis, and here's my z-axis. And I have some point in space here, x, y, z. I'm going to let rho be its distance from the origin. Right. And the reason I'm not using r is I'm saving r for later. The amount I come down from the z-axis, I'm going to call that phi. Has anybody here done coordinates in physics yet for spherical coordinates? Okay, good. So if you haven't seen it before, then you'll at least memorize it this way. Oh, you've seen it?
No.
Okay.
Phi, what is that?
So phi is just one of the Greek letters. So we often use theta and phi for angles. Okay. Do you think you need to memorize spherical coordinates? What do you think? You need to memorize spherical, you need to memorize cylindrical, you need to memorize polar, or you need to be able to quickly rederive them on the spot. It's not that bad. Right? How many of you know who the little three are? Yes.
Like our little three?
Like yes.
Wesleyan and Williams.
Okay, so that wasn't that bad. Okay, so you've demonstrated that you can memorize three things. Excellent. Who knows who the big three are?
Harvard,
Keats,
and
Yale. Yes, although I'd put Yale first. But. All right, so you need to memorize the big three coordinate changes. You need to memorize polar, you need to memorize cylindrical, you need to memorize spherical, or you need to be able to derive them on the spot. If this angle is phi is coming down from the z-axis, I want to figure out what my height is. Well, the easiest height would be is if phi is 0. What would be my height if phi is 0?
Z.
What would be my z-height in terms of rho? So I'm a distance rho from the origin, and my angle is 0. I don't come down at all from the z-axis. What would be my z-height? Yes.
Rho.
It would just be rho. If I come down 180 degrees, what would be my value of z?
Negative rho.
If I come down 90 degrees, what would be my rho now? It would be cosine 90, which is 0. In general, if I go down rho, what would be my z? Yes.
Rho
times the cosine. So z is just rho cosine phi. And that's going to give us the height coming down. So this is just rho cosine phi. This is our z. Okay? So that's how much we've come down. Now, we're going to allow rho only to take on positive values. Phi, how much we come down? Do you think phi comes down from 0 to 90 to 180 to 270 back up to 360? Or do you think I only have to go down 180? 180. Because once I go down a certain amount, I can now spin around. I can do a great, you know, skating move. And I can spin around 360 degrees. Right? So it's enough for phi to go from 0 to 180 or from 0 to pi. Because my theta, my x, y rotation, my xy angle is going to go from 0 to 360 or 0 to 2 pi. I don't want to double count things. So what do you think this length is going to be over here? So it's rho cosine phi up here. It's rho over here. What would that length be?
Rho sine.
Rho sine phi. So we have a right triangle here. We love right triangles. And so if you look at what's projected downward here, this is now a length parallel to the xy plane, but just at a height, rho cosine phi. So if I look just down in xy land, I've got a vector now of length rho sine phi. And now I'll call this angle here theta. In polar coordinates, what would you want to call rho sine phi?
R.
You'd want to call that r. And now the x down here, you just get x is r cosine theta, and you get y is r sine theta. And this is why mathematicians like to use theta and r down here, and they like to use rho for the spherical distance. Because now when they collapse down to a plane parallel to the xy plane, they're now just using polar coordinates. And in polar coordinates, you have r and theta. That's why we're doing things like this. So z would be rho cosine phi, y would be r sine theta, but r is rho sine phi, so you get rho sine phi sine theta, and you would get x is rho sine phi cosine theta. You would have rho is greater than or equal to 0, 0 less than or equal to phi, less than or equal to pi, and then 0 less than or equal to theta, which will then be less than 2 pi. So these would be spherical coordinates. There is one place where the spherical coordinates break down. Any thoughts?
Origin.
The origin. But again, it's only one point. The breakdown is not that bad. It won't be a big deal. And if you look at x squared plus y squared plus z squared, you'll get rho squared, rho squared, rho squared, sine squared, cosine squared, cosine squared, sine squared. Cosine squared plus sine squared is 1, and then sine squared plus cosine squared is 1. You'll get x squared plus y squared plus z squared is rho squared, which makes sense with writing things down in spherical coordinates. So let's do an example. So in Cartesian coordinates, let's look at x squared plus y squared plus z squared equals 1. X squared plus y squared. What kind of object do you think this is? It's a sphere. What's the radius of the sphere? 1. If I had done x squared plus y squared plus z squared equals 4, it'd be a sphere of radius 2. What if I now do less than equal to 1? Now it's a filled-in sphere. Okay. So let's look at this in in spherical coordinates. Well, when you substitute for x, when you substitute for y, when you substitute for z, when you square everything, and when you simplify, you just get rho squared is less than or equal to 1. Well, since rho is non-negative, rho squared less than or equal to 1 is the same as rho is less than or equal to 1. So what kind of object is rho is less than or equal to 1? If I want to draw this in spherical coordinates, what will it look like?
It'll be a box.
It'll be a box. So all I get in polar is in spherical coordinates, it's going to be a box. And this gives you an idea of why we like spherical coordinates. Rather than working with a sphere, we can now work with a box. If I wanted to integrate over a sphere, what's the range x would go on a sphere? What's the smallest x could be on a sphere?
Negative
1. So we'd have x goes from negative 1 to 1. We'd have y goes from negative square root of 1 minus x squared to the square root of 1 minus x squared. And then z would go from negative square root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared to the square root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared. This should fill you with fright and make you go, now, when does shopping period end? What's right? This is why we want to do spherical coordinates. In spherical coordinates, what would this look like? Something a lot nicer. And so in spherical coordinates, we would have, rho goes from 0 to 1. We would have phi goes from 0 to pi. We would have theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. It sets up a lot nicer. Okay. Out of curiosity, how many of you remember the volume of a sphere? Yes.
4/3 pi r cubed.
Good. And what's the surface area?
4/3 pi r squared. No.
No. All right, let's do a circle. What's the area of a circle of radius r? Pi r squared. What's its perimeter?
2 pi.
Do you notice anything?
Yes.
On the derivative?
Yeah. Do you think this is a coincidence? So let's look at a sphere. The volume is 4/3 pi r cubed. The surface area is 4 pi r squared. Again, we get there by taking a derivative. It's not a coincidence. There is a reason why these are derivatives. This is also a quick way for you to remember how you get from one to the other. So if you remember what the formula is for the volume, you can get the surface area. If you remember the formula for the surface area, you can integrate backwards and get the formula for the volume. Okay? All right, so we've got about 5 minutes left. We have enough time to start doing level sets. All right, you've seen level sets all your life. How many of you have ever seen a weather map? You can look at places of constant temperature. Right? What is it called if you have the same temperature as other people? What's that line called? Anybody know?
Isotherm.
And if you have the same pressure, it's called an isobar. So a level set is essentially all points, all inputs that have the same output under a function. So the level set of f of height c is all points that evaluate, do you want a glass of water? Okay. That evaluate to C under F. Okay? So the level set will be all the points that evaluate. So isotherm, same temperature. Isobar, same alcohol content. No, sorry. Same pressure. So you might have seen, for instance, some maps of places. You could look at all points at the same height above sea level. And if I tell you I want to look at this height, that'll give me maybe those points in the Purple Valley. So it's just a convenient way of collecting all the points. Maybe I have a function f of x, y, z is x squared plus y squared plus z squared. So the level sets of that would be different spheres. The level set of value 1 would be a sphere of radius 1. The level set of value 4 would be a sphere of radius 2. Let me give you a more interesting example, but essentially the same one. So in one variable, we often look at y equals f of x. And in a situation like that, when we look at y equals f of x, y is giving us our height. In two dimensions, I might look at z equals f of x, y. And you give me an x and a y, and this will tell me how high up I go. So I could look at, as an example, f of x, y equals z. And maybe I'll take f of x, y to be the square root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared. So if I have z equals the square root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared, what kind of shape do you think this is? So what do you think this would look like? So you would have z is the square root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared. I don't like square roots. You don't like square roots. What should we do? Square. So we'll get z squared is 1 minus x squared minus y squared. Does this now look a little bit more familiar as to what shape this might be? It should be a sphere. Is it a sphere? Or is it close to a sphere? Yes. It's half a sphere. Z can't be negative. I can't put an x and y such that I would have 1 minus something greater than 1. I can only take on positive values. So this is actually only going to give me the top of the sphere. So this is a hemisphere. And here the level sets are just going to be disks or circles a certain height above the xy plane. So for instance, let's calculate the level set with C equals four-fifths. So I want to find all x and y such that the square root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared equals four-fifths. So find all x, y such that the square root of 1 minus x squared minus y squared equals 4/5. You might begin to guess that 4/5 was not randomly chosen. Right, when you see 4/5, what do you think of? Probably 3, 4, 5 triangles. So if I square both sides, I get 1, which I'm going to write as 25/25, anticipating what happens, minus x squared plus y squared equals 16/25. And so if I just move things over, I get x squared plus y squared equals, just doing a lot of the algebra quickly, 3/5 squared. Ah, what's that the equation of? Circle. So the level set with C equals 4/5 is a circle with radius 3/5, if you want, and height 4/5. Okay. So all we're going to really need level sets for is some things that's actually just going to be theoretically nice. But the main idea is a level set is just a collection of inputs that all get sent to the same thing. So it's places where things are all constant. If you ignore all the JAs, what do you think would be constant in your dormitory? I'm sorry? Wow, we got that close to Lord of the Flies. People have at least read Lord of the Flies?
Yeah.
All right, there we go. What would be constant if we got rid of the JAs? And you don't need the conch to answer. Everybody would be a freshman, right? So you would have, I don't know, maybe like an ISO class where everybody would be the same class year. This is not the same in upper class housing where you allow things to be mixed. Level set is just a convenient way of saying take all the points that output to the same place and just give that a name. And a lot of times these are really nice regions. And you might say you have a trajectory and you might be constrained to lie on a level set. You know, my path is going to be this ellipse or this hyperbola or something like that. All right, so this is a good place to stop for today. If you haven't handed in your homework, please do so. If you haven't grabbed your homework, please do so.